Connor O'Gara on the telephone right now. O'Gara, of course, he is over at Saturday Down South, joining us every Monday. Connor, you are a northerner who has lived in the South now for a while. Do you miss the snow days? And what did you used to do on snow days?
No, I mean, I don't really miss it. I think that there are certain elements to it that as you get older, you just get more frustrated with, like driving in it. It's such a pain. And I was out in Nebraska for a few years, and driving my 97 Corolla down I-80 was something that I didn't really like doing very much. So I do not miss the snow. But snow days were usually like, hey, we're going to play some snow football. We're going to basically treat this like it's one long vacation. Now, I think they're a little overrated. You still end up having to do homework. But, I mean, they're fun, I guess.
Yeah. Single day is a different thing than, like, William H. Macy moment in Fargo where it's just it's a way of life and you're sick of chipping the ice off of your windshield. Weird weekend in college football. We thought nothing would happen. It turned out a lot of stuff happened, so much so that you had to do an emergency Saturday Down South podcast yesterday because of the Gus Malzahn firing. But I thought maybe, you know, what happened between LSU and Florida and the shoe-throwing incident and perhaps Florida having a chance at a national championship run thrown away might have been enough.
It was stunning. And for those who were saying that it was going to be a bleak Saturday and they were just hoping to get to the end, I think that by the end of the weekend, you realize, oh, wow, this is college football, and it's always entertaining, even when you think it's not going to be entertaining. That LSU-Florida game was one of the more unpredictable results I've seen in recent memory. And I go back to this belief going into that game that Florida, even if it didn't necessarily keep its foot on the gas, even if LSU got up for that game because it's a rivalry game and they're not playing in a bowl game, so that's kind of their bowl game, you know, it's still Dan Mullen versus Bo Pelini, which I'm going to take that matchup 10 times out of 10 for Dan Mullen. And ultimately, it was Bo Pelini who was able to dial up turnovers in that game. And to see a game end in that fashion where, you know, there are very few moments where as a neutral observer, you stand up from where you're seated and you're just in a moment of disbelief. And I go back to the Elijah Moore, you know, fake dog celebration last year in the Egg Bowl and this year with Marco Wilson throwing that shoe. It just kind of makes you realize, oh, my gosh. Can't, like, if you saw this script, you would say to yourself, all right, this is ridiculous. This isn't actually how things work in real life. That happened, and we saw a team lose its playoff chances in part because a player threw a shoe, as the official said, 20 yards downfield.
Honestly.
I mean, seriously. I was just blown away, and then you have the Gus Malzahn news. I mean, I could talk forever about all the wackiness that happened this weekend, but it just goes to show you don't ever go into a weekend assuming that everything's going to be boring and you're not going to be entertained.
I definitely want to touch on the Auburn job being open and how that figures in on things, but we watched Alabama just demolish Arkansas, and the Razorbacks were not at full strength. Not like that would have made that much of a difference. But, you know, when I see that Alabama's outscored opponents 495-168, they've had zero close games. I understand Notre Dame is good. Clemson is good. I think I'd give Alabama the national championship right now, to be honest. I understand we still have to do this whole rigmarole of rankings and bowl games and all of that. That's the national champion. And, Connor, I'm not sure if it would be close at all.
Yeah, the only thing that I wonder about, and don't get me wrong, Alabama is in the playoffs right now. Even if they lose by 30 and suffer the worst loss of the Saban era, this team is in the playoffs. I firmly believe that. Anybody that's denying that, you know, has their head in the sand. But the one thing that I wonder about, this team has been remarkable since that Ole Miss game, this defense specifically. This group has not seen a truly elite quarterback who can stretch the field. Now, if they see Notre Dame in the semifinal, Ian Book isn't doing that with that group of receivers. But if they see a Trevor Lawrence, if they see a Justin Fields, how do they adjust to that? Because they really have not seen that guy since Matt Corral, who's going to take those chances downfield and is going to not be afraid to just let it loose. And I think that's an area where you would maybe have just a bit of skepticism about Alabama, as proven as they are, as complete of a team as they look like they are. that's just a little bit of an unknown. But we're splitting hairs at this point, right? Because they've been far and away the most dominant team in college football. Even Notre Dame, who's had a really good resume at this point, a resume that only got better with UNC blowing out Miami. This is still a Notre Dame team that has played 5 of its 10 games within 14 points. Alabama doesn't have one such game. I mean, that's how dominant the Crimson Tide have been this year. And yeah, Bama, there's Bama fatigue, but I mean, let's give credit where credit's due.
Well, they're going to face a team that's like that on Saturday in the SEC championship game to cap off. It'll be an interesting day in college football. You know, I mean, that what you're talking about, a quarterback that can stretch the field, a team that's got lots of weapons offensively, that's Florida. It's just the Gators don't have a defense to be able to stop Alabama at all.
Exactly. And I'm very interested to see how that plays out because, you know, I think that Florida and what happened against LSU, there's a lot, you could spin it whatever way you want. You could say, hey, they're going to go into this game against Alabama now, just let it loose, knowing that, you know, I still don't think they have a path to the playoffs, even if they beat Alabama, just because I think A&M, with one less loss and the win against Florida, would get into the field, and I think Alabama's already in. So I think that you could look at that and say, yeah, Florida does have a chance potentially to put Alabama on its heels a little bit, and they could do some things. But I think Bama's able to get enough stops against this offense. I mean, we just saw Bo Pelini dial up enough plays to be able to force Florida into tough spots, and albeit without Kyle Pitts, I think having him is a game changer. Nobody's been able to stop him when he's been on the field. But, you know, I think that this is an interesting game for Alabama just because it'll show us a lot about how complete they are going into the playoff with that aforementioned question about a quarterback that's the field.
Connor O'Gara here with us on Halftime. Connor, let's get to the big news that, like Phil mentioned at the start of the interview, just the breaking news that came across and it shocked a lot of people. And the more you think about it, really, I don't know if it necessarily shocked me now, but I'm talking about Gus Malzahn fired at Auburn. And kind of a two-parter, were you shocked or not at the news? And was this a move to go get Hugh Freeze?
Yes and yes. In my opinion, yeah. I expected Auburn to stand pat. When you see a number like that, $21 million, I mean, that is a lot of money in normal times. And I get it. It's a pandemic, but it's not necessarily the Auburn University. You know, it's not going just, that money isn't just coming from, you know, the Auburn University president or, you know, the money that's raised, you know, just within the, you know, the school itself. It's boosters. It's big time people who are willing to pay that type of money. And they got to the point where they said, you know what? Year 8, we're frustrated. We've had 7 consecutive seasons with at least 4 losses. And, you know, I don't know if Gus Malzahn's comment about it being a solid year in a normal year, if it's 6-4 in SEC play, had anything to do with it, or it was just his quarterback again looking inept on the road on Saturday night. I don't know. But I do think that this, you make a move like that to go after somebody like Brees, you pay $21 million if you have a plan. Because the coaching carousel is not spinning very fast right now. There's not a whole lot of big-time names out there who really would feel good about getting that job and justifying spending that much money. Because Auburn wasn't a bad team. They weren't as good as the likes of an Alabama or a Georgia. But I think Hugh Freeze just makes a lot of sense now. I thought it made a lot of sense in South Carolina. Apparently the timing didn't work out there. I think it's even more attractive for him to succeed his friend at Auburn and take over that job.
Let's just assume for some reason that Hugh Freeze doesn't take this job, or for whatever reason he decides to stay at Liberty. Who do you go after next if you're Auburn, if there is no Hugh Freeze out there?
I like Mario Cristobal, and I think what he's done at Oregon is impressive. You know, a former Nick Saban assistant, of course. I mean, how many of those can we just have a Nick Saban assistant at every single SEC program, and we're trending in that direction at this point. But I think what he's done at Oregon is really impressive, and his ability to establish the line of scrimmage is impressive. But he doesn't necessarily come as this up-and-coming play caller who's going to reinvent what Auburn is doing offensively. So maybe there's a little bit of hesitation there. Kevin Steele is kind of the dark horse candidate to get this job. You know, I know everybody's going offensive-minded these days, but Kevin Steele spent the last 5 years becoming one of the best defensive minds in the sport at Auburn. And there's a lot of people there who think that, you know, he deserves a chance. And if that's ultimately the route they want to go and then spend big on a coordinator, of course, that would make a lot of people on the Plains happy. And then the one to keep an eye out for, Lane Kiffin. I mean, Lane Kiffin is the one that, You just never know. You just never know with Lane, and you never know what that price tag would be. If Auburn wants to make a splash, that's the biggest possible splash that you can make. And there's no question that he can develop offensive talent. It would just be probably about Kiffin and whether or not he would want to be another one and done at a different program in the SEC. But that's the one that, until it doesn't happen, you just got to kind of keep it in the back of your mind that it could happen.
That'd be insane if that happened, if he'd left Ole Miss to go to Auburn. All right, let's look at the other side of the bill. Gus Malzahn, what do you think he does next? Do you think he goes to a coordinator role? I personally think he'll stay in a head coaching role at some form or fashion just because he's a good head coach for whatever you want to think about him or not. Where do you think he goes now? Do you think he hits the Bama rehab program and joins you an analyst there? Or do you think another head coaching job is in his future pretty quick?
I think ultimately he's going to take a step back. I've always got the sense that Gus has been in this high pressure job and he's wound tight. I mean, he's always kind of been wound tight. And I get it with the stakes there and having Alabama doing what it's doing. I kind of always have thought that when Gus's time was up at Auburn, that he would take at least a year off. Maybe he's going to go to the media role and do that for a year. I don't think he really has to. I think his name is still going to be out there and he's still going to be one of these guys here for openings at various places. But, you know, this is somebody with high school roots. This is somebody who could spend a year just watching high school football and traveling a ton, and, you know, enjoying the fact that he's got $21 million on the way, half of which is due to him in the next 30 days. I think that he's a guy who could take a step back and stay in Auburn, just keep the pulse of the college football game and just kind of go from there. I think he's going to have Group of Five interest as a head coach. I think there's somebody who would definitely hire him as a Power Five offensive coordinator. I don't necessarily think that Power Five head coach in 2021 is imminent, but you never know. I mean, you never know, but he certainly doesn't have any sort of financial motivation when he's getting all that money from Auburn.
Connor, let's wrap this up with a nice big bow, okay, with a theory here. Chad Morris got Gus Malzahn fired because Bo Nix did not get any better throughout this season, and Auburn's offense really wasn't very good. Chad Morris ought to be the next offensive coordinator at Arkansas State working for Butch Jones. Have fun with that.
Oh, man. I mean, the content that would come from that would just be, that's a dream right there. We might have to get, like, a paid Arkansas State beat reporter at SDS if that happens. I mean, that would be too good of an opportunity to pass up. We'll get boots on the ground down there. Every Butch Jones / Chad Morris press conference. I mean, that's a match made in heaven. Let's make that happen. You know what? I think we need to put together a Twitter campaign. Let's do it. I think we could all benefit from this.
You bring up Butch Jones real quick before we let you go. Obviously, he's a new head coach at Arkansas State. That's a good get if you're Arkansas State to kind of get a guy that's been in that Bama quote-unquote rehab program, had success at Tennessee for a short period of time. I think that's a good get for Arkansas State.
Yeah, I'm interested. I'm interested to see, you know, how he does in a job that is in Tennessee where you can't go there and say things like champions of life and five-star hearts and get away with it, whereas at Arkansas State, maybe you can. Maybe that type of stuff works. I've always thought Butch was a little bit more geared for the Group of Five role. Of course, he had a lot of success before he came to Tennessee doing just that. And I think that could make a lot of sense for him. And there are a lot of people saying, yeah, it's a terrible move, blah, blah, blah. I'm willing to see how it works out and see what he's learned from his time off, because I think coaches benefit from that. And I think that he could be in an interesting spot. I'm looking forward to seeing the next chapter of the Butch Jones era.
Connor, have a great week. Looking forward to what should be a very interesting Saturday in college football that caps off with the SEC championship game. So looking forward to chatting about it on Monday again.
Sounds good. Appreciate it, guys.